When Instagram expanded its web app to include stories, filters, and direct messaging, they hit a critical performance bottleneck, causing their app to slow down dramatically. In this video, we're going to find out how they managed to reduce their feed page load time by almost 50%. Their web app contains many different and connected components, requiring the browser to discover resources only after parsing and executing the preceding JavaScript. This can create a cascade of delays, especially for dynamic features where resources couldn't be preemptively loaded. The Instagram team tried to implement resource prefetching to preload JavaScript and GraphQL requests in an effort to boost performance using HTML preload attribute. It is a way to tell the browsers to start downloading resources before the JavaScript that would normally request them had been downloaded and executed. This works if you know what you want ahead of time. If only my brain works like that. However, prefetching caused issues as some resources intended for later steps were prioritized over those needed for immediate rendering. To resolve this, they adjusted script loading to match the exact sequence required by the page. They also needed to optimize their infinite feed feature to ensure smooth performance and efficient resource use. This involved avoiding CPU and bandwidth competition with current visible content, prevent wasteful preloading of unseen content, and manage responsive image effectively. Their solution involved a prioritized task system using Request ID Callback, a browser API that allows developers to schedule low priority tasks during idle times when the browser isn't handling any critical work. Initially, the system queued the next batch of feed posts at idle priority, dynamically upgrading to high priority if a user approached a specific threshold near the feed's end. This was implemented using a hidden media prefetch component that matched the feed's dimension, ensuring the correct image size were chosen with HTML source sets attribute. This attribute allows developer to specify multiple image resolutions, enabling the browser to select the best option based on the user's network capability. After this optimization, photo loading time reduced by 25%, time spent waiting at feed end reduced by 56%, and this was achieved without compromising the performance of currently visible content. Even after implementing preloading, they noticed that their GraphQL queries were experiencing significant delays. GraphQL, that's a word I haven't heard in a while. This was because in a traditional setup, the server needs to send the complete HTML document to the client. Then the client needs to download and execute the JavaScript bundles. Only after all these steps are done can the client begin to start making GraphQL requests, which can cause significant delay. So instead of waiting for the entire page to be ready, they decided to use HTTP chunk transfer encoding. When a user requests a page, the server immediately knows what GraphQL queries that page will need. Using this knowledge, they implemented a system where the server starts executing those queries right away, while simultaneously beginning to stream the initial HTML to the client. The server sends the HTML head section, which includes a JSON cache setup. As the server completes each GraphQL query, it streams the result directly to the client as additional HTML chunks, which get stored in this cache. By the time the JavaScript code executes an attempt to make GraphQL queries, the data is already there in the cache. After these changes, they saw amazing results for their mobile users, who often face higher network latencies. Desktop users experienced a 14% improvement in page display completion time, while mobile saw an increase in 23%. The team realized that while server-side optimization was important, the fastest data transfer was one that didn't happen at all. I can be wise too, ready? The best code is no code.
Obama out.
This prompted them to explore client-side caching strategies, particularly for the feed and stories features where users often revisit similar content. They implemented a cache-first approach, choosing to store a subset of their data in the browser's IndexedDB, which is a NoSQL database built into modern web browsers that allow you to store and retrieve data directly in the user's browser. This would allow them to immediately present the users with their previous feed and stories content while fetching fresh data in the background. While this sounded promising, it also introduced a complex technical challenge. Managing user interactions with cached content while the brief window before new data arrives. This is clearly shown in the like scenario. When a user loads Instagram, their cached feed might show a page post, so you gotta smash that like button. However, when the fresh feed data arrives moments later, without proper handling, this new data feed overwrites a user's recent like action. This race condition needed a solution that could preserve user interaction while maintaining data consistency. So they drew inspiration from Git's version control and built a staging system. Incoming server data acts as a main branch, while the cache feed states are treated like a feature branch. This enables a rebase-like operation for user interactions. When fresh data arrives, the system replays all cache user interactions on top of the new data before committing to the app state. Are you a Git merge or a Git rebase kind of person? The staging manager handled three key phases: display cache data while fetching fresh content, track user interactions during the fetch, merging fresh data with stage interaction before updating the application state. Feed display ended up with a 2.5% improvement, while story display's time improved by 11%. With a growing mobile user base, CPU limitations often had a greater impact than network speed. This made it crucial to optimize both the size and execution efficiency of their JavaScript code. While many developers focus on reducing the compressed JavaScript size, the Instagram team discovered that the uncompressed size was actually more important. This was because regardless of how efficient the code was transmitted, every byte still needed to be parsed and executed on the user's device. This became especially apparent when they implemented Brodly compression. It did reduce network transfer size by 20%, but they saw no significant improvement in the actual page load times. After further investigation, they identified three main areas for further optimization. The first one is reducing the critical path JavaScript and improving code execution efficiency. They developed a metric called critical bytes per route to track the amount of JavaScript that needed to be executed before a page could become interactive. This helped them focus their optimization efforts where they would have the most impact. The other optimization is the implementations of inline requirements. This technique borrowed from React Native's Metro Bundler fundamentally changed how code modules were loaded. This transformation had two significant benefits. Modules were only loaded when actually used, avoiding unnecessary initialization costs. The execution cost was then spread out over time rather than concentrated at startup. Another major optimization came from serving different JavaScript bundles to different browsers. They created two versions of their code, a modern ES2017 bundle for user browsers, which includes about 50% of their user base, and then a legacy ES5 bundle for older browsers like Internet Explorer, if you remember what that is. This approach allowed them to avoid unnecessary transpiration for browsers that supported modern JavaScript features. The difference in bundle size was significant. Their core JS bundle size became 5.7 smaller for modern browsers, leading to a 3% improvement in feed page load time. Instagram's performance optimization journey yielded impressive results, with the highlight being a 50% reduction in feed page load time. There are three key lessons from this. Smaller compressed bundles don't always mean better performance. Measuring user experience is critical. Performance optimization is an ongoing process, not a one-time effort. What do you think of their implementation? I hope you get to learn something new today. Before I end the video, I just want to take a moment to thank every single one of you for tuning in and helping this channel grow. It feels incredibly rewarding when I hear you're actually getting value from these videos. Ultimately, that's all I really want from this channel, to share what I learned. Well, as always, thank you so much for watching and see you in the next one.